Hello, this is Eva from Soul GPS. Welcome to my channel. How can you tell if somebody you just met and starting to date is a narcissist, potentially toxic, somebody with a covert agenda, or if it's a healthy person who can actually bring a lot of fun and excitement into your life? It can be really difficult to tell because in both cases, in the beginning when you just met this person, there are heightened levels of attraction and connection that can be quite blinding to reality. You may feel like the world is kind of closing around you, so the intimacy becomes also heightened. There is a deep exchange of information, and it can be difficult to tell whether it is done in order to extract information from you or if it's just genuine sharing, you know, wanting to get to know you and wanting to get to know who you are so that this person feels closer to you. So it can be difficult. So what I did is, since this has been a question that's been coming up quite a bit lately in my comments and emails from you, is that I wanted to give you a compilation of 15 signs, 15 things to look out for when you're just meeting somebody new, when you just met someone new, especially something to look out for during the first couple of months of the courtship. So let's dive into it. The first sign, the first thing you wanna pay close attention to is how does your body feel? Do you feel calm and slightly energized, which is generally how you feel when you meet somebody of good quality, somebody who is really genuinely interested in you, versus your body feeling adrenalized and maybe some of the old wounds starting to flare up? So you're feeling anxious, maybe you have some obsessive thoughts about your past and about this person. Do you have propensity to fantasize a lot? Meaning that when you're not with this person, you're already letting your imagination run wild and think about the things that are possible. And the idea of it not coming true makes you feel really bad and anxious. So that's the first thing you want to pay attention to. How does your body feel? The second thing you want to pay attention to is whether things are matching. So while you're meeting with this person, while you're having a conversation with them, do you feel like there might be a disconnect between, say, what you're hearing and how you're feeling as a result? So is your body, because our bodies are incredibly attuned to detail, is your body picking up something that maybe it's really difficult for you to put your finger on? Maybe there's an inconsistency in the story, which is another thing that may not be matching. Maybe not necessarily the words versus the feelings, but it could be the words and the words. Like that you heard something in the story that they were telling you that just didn't seem to add up and match up with what you heard maybe last time, right? And there's just things that are not adding up. In a normal circumstance, when you just met somebody who's, again, very genuine and honest and is transparent with you, the conversation tends to flow more organically. There aren't these big jumps between, you know, talking about stuff that's more superficial to something that's extremely deep and intimate. Like that could be a warning sign. So if things are not matching, that's something to pay attention to. Number three, you find yourself trying too hard, and maybe also the other person is trying too hard too. So there's this pressure to be perfect that's coming from the both of you. You know, it's okay to feel a little bit nervous when you've just met somebody. Of course, you wanna, you know, show up the best way that you can, show yourself in the best light. But if you find yourself having to pretend to be someone you're not in order to impress somebody, this could be a sign that you are entering somebody else's reality where you can't be yourself. And that's a sign to really take note of. What else? Number four is the stare. You notice there's this weird way that they're looking at you. And I actually made a video about the narcissistic stare. You can look it up to go a little bit deeper into what that means. But it's kind of like this sense of like being sized up. Like this person is kind of looking you up and down. And it's like in the back of their mind, they're calculating. You know, you feel objectified. You feel like maybe even you know, in the back of their mind, like they're not really hearing what you have to say. They're not really paying attention to that, but instead they're already kind of having their way with you. They're imagining things, and it's a subtle cue, but something that your body can definitely pick up. And again, send you that message that something is off here. It's not a genuine look where it's, again, transparency and easy flow, easy connection, but rather it's kind of like, they're kind of like moved back and they're sizing you up. Number five, the conversation turns into an interview. So again, there isn't this easy back and forth, like what I throw a ball, you throw a ball, and so on. And it's this sort of gradual ascension towards more intimacy and deeper sharing, but rather it's like this barrage of questions that are being fired at you, and you feel like you're in an interview. You're feeling like, you know, they really want to find out things about you, and it's like, it may not make sense why so much so quickly. And again, this can be an area that can be blinding, because most of us love attention. So if somebody is asking us all these questions and they're penetrating deeply quickly, they want to know these things about you, you may feel like, wow, this is so nice, because maybe one of the wounds that you carry is that you don't feel like you are, you know, like you've been seen by your parents. You feel like you've been neglected and ignored most of your life. So that can get in the way, and you can kind of get like this, again, it's a sense of feeling adrenalized, like you feel this intense rush, this intensity, where you're like, wow, like somebody wants to know all these things about me. That must mean that they think I'm special. So something, again, to be discerning about here and pay attention to. Number six is they lead with a sad story, a victim story. So you just met this person, say you're at the party, or, you know, you're out on a date, and one of the first things they tell you is something devastating that happened to them in their childhood, you know, or something where they've been traumatized. And it doesn't necessarily need to mean that that's not true, because in a lot of cases, people who are narcissistic and abusive have experienced abuse themselves in their childhood, but most of them use this particular step. And it's used in the pickup artist community. So, you know, you may not be dealing necessarily with somebody who's highly pathological, though you can, but it could be something that's been trained, but it still has that ulterior motive of manipulation and wanting to control the other person, wanting to control their emotions. So they will tell you these things, this sad story, to evoke emotions in you, to make you feel empathic towards them. It's really to test your empathy and to test your altruism, to see how much they can sort of dump on you and how much reverb they can find in you when it comes to you understanding them and being there for them. And usually when you get that kind of character, you're going to find that they're not going to be too interested in your sad story when it's your turn to talk. And that's actually number seven that I want to talk about, is display of feigned concern for you. Because usually when they lead with a sad story, it's also to make you talk about things that hurt you, so that they're able to find out what your vulnerabilities are. But when you share your vulnerabilities, there may be this kind of overdone display of concern when they hold your hand and they're like, oh my God, you know, I feel you're here. Oh, poor you. But it's like, it's too much. It's too syrupy. It's not authentic. It's not genuine. And then they may quickly change the subject. So it's not that they really want to hear about your sad story too, but they just wanted to find out what that is. They make a check mark in the back of their mind, like, okay, so now I know what this person needs and what they've been through, so I can use it against them. Number eight is there's bragging and comparison. So say you're having the conversation and you're telling them some fun story, something exciting, something that happened to you that, say, made you feel really elated or made you feel special. What they will tend to do then is kind of like undercut that and tell you, well, let me tell you what happened to me today. Or let me tell you what somebody else told me, you know, when I was in a similar situation as you were. So there's this sense of competitiveness when they want to kind of beat you and outshine you so that they feel better than you. So that's definitely something to take a note of and pay attention to. Again, in all these cases, we're going to revert back to number one, which is your body feels off, things are not adding up, you know, the early two steps. Because when these things are happening, when you're feeling like this person is competing with you, or like they're, you know, telling you a sad story that's there for a reason, it's not genuine, it's just, it serves a purpose, your body will send you signs that something's off. Number nine is they ignore you. So again, it's kind of like they wanna tell you, let you know that you're not that important. Like at first they will make you feel very important, you know, by showering you with all this attention and questions and wanting to know everything about you. And then they will start ignoring you. They will flirt with the waitress. They will check their phone. They will say, oh, I need to make a quick phone call, or they will get the phone call and they're loud. They're, you know, trying to stir up drama around them and attention around them to, again, pull that away from you. So there's, again, not this sort of easygoing flow between you, but there's this need to now take back the energy that they have given you for themselves. And number 10 is you receive criticisms and doses of sarcasms that, again, feel off. So again, you just met, it's still pretty early on in the relationship, a month, maybe two, and there's this increasing frequency of them undercutting you, letting you know things that just don't feel good, criticizing maybe your car or the way that you look, and maybe not even doing it in a straightforward way, but in a covert way where they may say, you know, they may criticize somebody who will say it's similar to you, and in a way then send you a message. And if you start to then feel bad about it and be like, maybe even make a comment like, what did you mean X, Y, and Z? Why did you say such thing? You know, what did you mean by that? I would say like, I didn't mean that. Like, how can you, you're too sensitive. Like, how could you even think that I would do such thing, right? So that's how the covert narcissist is going to defend themselves from being critical, but they will still do these jabs. They will still criticize you. It's almost like they can't help themselves because they need to bring people around them down so that they can feel better. It's really toxic and quite sick. And they will do this also to test your boundaries, to see how much mistreatment you can take. So systematically, they will push harder and harder because they're trying to evoke that emotion. Because once they know what gets you off and what sets you off, now they feel like they have control over you. And that's the goal. Number 11, they will talk foul about their exes and subtly express their expectations of you through triangulation. So they will tell you things like, you know, my ex did X, Y, and Z. And of course you would never do that because you're so much nicer than that, right? You would never behave like that in public, or you would never leave me hanging when I needed help. That's what my ex used to do all the time. Things like that. In general, when you just met somebody and it's still pretty fresh, or still just starting today, getting to know each other, and they're bringing up negative things about the past, that's something, again, to be taken note of, because that is a sign of emotional immaturity in general. And when you are being triangulated this way pretty early on, and again, your body is telling you that something's off, you can always walk away and say no sooner rather than later. So rather than investing yourself emotionally and with your mind by, you know, imagining things you could do together and setting plans and doing that stuff, it's easier to just say no sooner than later. Number 12, your physical boundaries are being violated. So say you just get met this person, it's still really fresh, really, really early, their attraction is building, and yeah, maybe you want to kiss them, but they're going to like do a full on, you know, just push themselves onto you when it's really, you know, breaking your boundaries on a physical level as well, you know. And you can always say that you don't want to do that, but you find that the more you resist, the more they persist. And if they're being denied what they want, they're going to pout, you know, they're going to make you feel like you're just a bad person. And now they're not interested. They're going to give you the silent treatment. They will not call you for a couple of days or just be upset with you because you didn't let them push forward and be intimate with you sooner than they wanted to, because you know that too is another hook. Number 13, they text you past inappropriate time with unusual frequency and then go blank. So again, you come home from the date, they're texting you until 1 or 2 in the morning, you have to go to work the next day, you have plans, you have things to do, and they just won't let go. And say, when you finally say, okay, I gotta go to bed, the next day, they're not gonna text you for a few days because they got upset. So they're sending you a message that it's either their way or no way. And this can also tie with another video I made on sleep deprivation, which is a way to dysregulate your rhythm to make you much more susceptible to manipulation. So if this is something that they do, that's a big sign, that's a red flag that you may be dealing with somebody toxic. Of course, it's great when after you had a lovely date and a lovely time, person asks you, did you get home safely? If it's a man, if it's a woman, they may say something like, it was so great to see you, I look forward to meeting with you next time. You know, something that's appropriate, nice, short and succinct, and doesn't push those late night boundaries. Number 14, there's future faking and planting seeds too soon. So again, this person is, telling you about how they just can't imagine not spending the rest of their life with you. They're already planning their wedding. They're already dropping insinuations about, you know, talking about kids and talking about things that are just very intimate and deep and serious. And then they may also start to back out of it later down the road. These are the stories that I hear quite often in my work with my clients when they're like, you know, the first 2 months we were talking about having our future together, and then 5 months down the road, I can barely have them commit to going out to dinner together. So there's going to be that sudden drop of devaluation that can happen. Now this is a red flag, because while it feels really good to plant those seeds of future together, especially again if it's easy for you to have a connection with somebody and you love it, you enjoy it, just always put the brakes on and ask yourself, is this going too fast? And your body will tell you, your mind will tell you if it is. And finally, number 15 is intermittent reinforcement. And it is something that is a hallmark of toxic relationships. What it means is that there's high intensity and deep intimacy, lots of closeness. And so it's this kind of oscillation between enmeshment and painful separation. So at first, everything is great, you're very close, and then they vanish, you know, they ghost you. They don't text you for long hours or many days. And so there's this painful feeling of, like, you know, loss that happens early on while you're still just getting to know each other. If this happens, that's a sign that you're entering an abusive relationship, emotionally abusive relationship. They may not say anything that's, you know, sending you a direct message that things are bad. They may actually tell you all the right nice things. They may behave very appropriately, really nicely when you're together. But then if they're just leaving you cold and dropping you cold and neglecting your emotional needs early on, you can be sure that it's going to continue that way. So it's like a sensory overload followed by emptiness and lack. The rhythm is not balanced. You know, you feel like you can't count on this person. It's like a lottery. So if it starts that way, you can be sure it's going to get worse over time. So when you're beginning to date, you need to remain anchored in your body and listen to its messages. It will send you clear messages that your mind may distort, because rationalizations may come in, since you may want to make this relationship work so bad. You may imagine things there that are not really there. You want to give yourself also time. It's really important to cool off after having been through a toxic relationship. You know, so you can get in touch with your calm baseline, get in touch with yourself, your needs, and feel that peace. Because if you rush into the next one too soon, your feelings may be still too cloudy to guide you. So if you're in doubt, slow down. And a healthy relationship, now to contrast it, what I just said with how things ought to flow, if you met somebody who's really genuine and true, then here are some of them. Here's a short list. It's going to feel balanced in exchange. So there's an equal give and take between energy. It will feel relaxed and open. There will be an easy flow that deepens gradually. There will be sincerity and genuineness that will be palpable. Trust will form slowly and gradually. There will not be this push for wanting to share and do things with this person that feels unnatural. And the relationship doesn't inspire rumination and analysis when you're not together. If you're having a really nice thoughts, say, you know, you enjoyed the date, you're planning the next one, but you're still able to focus on doing what you need to do, then it's a good sign. If instead you're ruminating, you're breaking apart what they said, what they didn't say, things are not adding up in your mind, your body is sending you signs that something might be off, then it's likely that something is off. So I hope that you found this video helpful. Let me know in your comments below if you have any other red flags or warning signs that we should be paying attention to. And also, I'm very curious if you had an experience that's really positive, that felt really good. How did the courtship process flow for you? What are some of the signs to look out for that are actually positive and hopeful? So thank you so much for watching. Again, I hope this was helpful. I want to wish you good holiday season, peaceful, positive, surround yourself with good people, and I'm sending you all my best. Thank you. Bye.